Yeah, in this lecture, we'd be talking about some more techniques on the use the ground improvement essentially we'd be addressing vibro compaction methods. In this, as I just mentioned earlier, when the soil is very poor and you need to construct some sort of infrastructure on this particular soils, whether it is sandy soils, loose sands, or clay soils, we need to use some of these methods instead of going for pile foundations, which are quite expensive and also like energy intensive. So in these methods, what we see is that we just do the compaction at selected locations using vibrations, like we induce some sort of energy, and we use some equipment which results in compaction to large depths. As I just mentioned, say for example, if 10 meters is the depth of the soil to be compacted, like as I said, the SPT value should be about 20 or 25. We need to really have, other than what I just mentioned in the previous lectures, like dynamic compaction, many other methods which are quite scientific. Like, you know, there are many advantages here. So this particular techniques like vibro compaction methods are quite useful. Here the principle, as I just mentioned, is that it uses the vibratory energy, and then a small single float is there, and then when you introduce that particular float into the soil, it just vibrates, and then there is a densification that occurs because of the particle rearrangement. And zone of compaction around a single float is a function of the type of float. In fact, there are different types of floats, like their specifications, and the success of the in-situ densification depends on the grain size characteristics of the in-situ soils as well as that of backfill soil. What I meant by this is that, like, grain size distribution of soils plays a significant role. So for example, if you have gravel and sandy material, like you can see these materials here, this is A and B types. Here we just do what is called vibro compaction, in the sense at a selected point we just densify that, and then you finally, you know, from bottom you construct a column of densified material, like dense sand, instead of a pile foundation, say for example. So this is one important thing here. But in the case of clays, like, you know, you have clays and silts, what we do is that, since it's very difficult to get good you know, densities and good friction properties, we introduce some column of materials here, which are, again, we call it stone columns or sand columns and all that. So we use this material, and then we slowly withdraw the arrangement from the top. So that way a column is formed, and this is called vibro compaction methods, this is called vibro replacement methods. So both techniques make use of this vibration energy. And as I just mentioned, the soils in the zones A and B, which I said they are all more towards gravelly and sandy materials, they can be compacted by deep vibratory compaction equipment, and this is called vibro compaction. And while the soils of the zone C and D cannot be compacted by vibration alone, like vibration, you know, for example, in the clays, you can't do that. So soils in the zone C are often found on sites where liquefaction due to earthquakes is of concern. In fact, when the earthquake comes, particularly in sandy materials like loose sands and silts, the possibility that liquefaction occurs, the momentary loss of shear strength of soils, then whatever collapse occurs is of very, you know, significant magnitude. So we don't want to have this sort of issues also. So this, we would like to avoid this liquefaction as well. And this can be possible by, you know, use of stone columns. The soils in the zone D, say for example, they are all pure clays. They cannot be compacted by vibration, but they can be reinforced, in the sense you are putting sand or the stone material which has a higher strength. So we say that you are reinforcing the ground, you are stiffening the ground, and you can even drain the ground, because stone columns act as a drainage material as well. So this is what we are going to see today. There are some variations in the vibration techniques. For example, you have what is called vibro flotation. It refers to the compaction of the soil using a vibro float in a horizontal motion from the vibrator inserted into the ground. This is what you have the motion in the horizontal direction, and utilization of a top pile driving vibrator in a vertical mode is less efficient. In fact, this is a standard question that people have, like can I just use a vibration in the vertical direction, or why should I do it in the horizontal direction, or can I see the vibration has so for example, there is what is called natural frequency in vibrations. Like if I bring the natural frequency of the machine and whatever is the operating system, like vibrator, to the natural frequency of the soil itself, can there be any advantage? So these are all some questions people will have. So what people have seen is that you try to compact it in the horizontal manner in the using the float, like it's in some sort of arrangement, it's more efficient, whereas utilization of energy from top in the form of a vertical direction is not that efficient. The reason is simple, that the thing is that the we want to introduce lot of shear forces in soils, like shear resistance in the soils we would like to introduce. So when you have a columns like this, what happens is that the column is a stronger material, and even between the two columns you are making the material stronger. That is an objective part of objective of the whole issue here. So by laterally compacting, the possibility is that you would be compacting even the material that is in between, apart from trying to take control of the stone column itself, even the area that you are trying to do in the vertical manner, because you have a good control there. So the advantage, as I said, it is very clear that the vibration in the form of a horizontal movement is much better. Then people have used this concept of frequency of the vibro float matching that of natural frequency of the in-situ soil. But then there is a few companies, for example, a Miller-Resnett compaction technique. It's one technique people have been using. Actually, what happens is that many of these techniques are evolved. A particular contractor, particular group of people evolve the technique and they perfect the technique. So some companies may be happy with the first one, whereas some companies may be happy with a few other ones, like so essentially the equipment, the type of cranes, the type of movement, the all the process we have, they perfect the whole process over a period of time, and also that becomes their trump card in their when they deal with clients. So but then whatever is that, the process in the objective, the objective is the vibro compaction is to achieve the densification of the coarse grain soils. And as I just mentioned, if the silt and clay content is less, then it is very effective. And the effect of process is based on the fact that the particles of non-coercive soil can be rearranged by vibration, like particularly sands. Like you can see here, you have some before treatment, you have all these particles, and once you just vibrate it, all the particles, this gaps are there, the voids, they get rearranged, and there is so much settlement here. In the field, it can be as high as 1 meter, 2 meters. So that is what you do not want. So you would like to densify the system by in this manner in the field, and this is a typical example how it is done, and we will see more of that in the video. In a simple form, it is a penetration, then there is a vibration here, compaction is being done in the horizontal direction. Then you also backfill the material. Say for example, you can use the same sand or whatever material you have, make it much more whatever. So it can be done. So the vibro compaction is quite good for coarse grain soils with silt clay contents less than 10 to 15%, and the effects are that it results in increased shear strength, means the strength of the ground will be higher, so that the bearing capacity of the whole area will be higher, and settlements, increased stiffness is another thing. The stiffness, it becomes much more stiffer. So if you are trying to have some sensitive structures, definitely you need very good stiffness, and reduced liquefaction potential. This is another important thing that particularly when you are talking about recurrence of earthquakes in the particularly in India and many other places, you must be able to take care of the liquefaction potential as well. So definitely the use of these techniques have been of significant help in trying to achieve this goal. And where are the common applications? Of course, there are many, like building foundations, chemical plants, storage tanks, silos, pipelines, wharf structures, embankments, roads, both land and offshore applications. Like if you want to do something in the land or offshore, you have many applications here. So the depth is, in fact, they are able to achieve about 60 meters, which is quite big. Like, so that is about vibro compaction. What about vibro replacement? The vibro replacement is a technique of constructing stone columns through the fill material and the weak soil to improve the load bearing capacity and settlement characteristics. Like, you do not want to have large settlements, or you do not want the load bearing capacity, you would like to have the load bearing capacity improved. So the advantage or the difference is that here you have a lot of fine grained soils which do not densify effectively under vibrations. Hence, it is necessary to form stone columns to reinforce and improve materials, weak, cohesive and mixed soils. The principle of vibro replacement is that the stone columns and the intervening soil, means the between the two stone columns, there you have a soil, it forms an integrated foundation support which has low compressibility, like less settlements, and also improved load bearing capacity. In cohesive soils, excessive pore pressure is readily dissipated by the stone columns, and for this reason reduced settlements occur at a faster rate than that is observed in the case of cohesive soils. This is a very important point, that apart from increasing the load carrying capacity of the ground, they also have less settlements. The drainage is faster. Like, you know, say for example, in the case of clays, the consolidation is so slow, the process is a time dependent process, like it can take 5-10 years or 6 years, or you know, so you do not want that. You know, if you want to construct a building on a soft soil, you cannot wait for the consolidation to complete. So you would like to accelerate the consolidation, complete the consolidation, say for example, it has to occur 1 meter, 2 meters, let it happen faster so that you can construct the building. That is what we do here. So as I just mentioned, this is the process showing the vibro replacement, and then these are the techniques. And here, as opposed to just a densification in the case of vibro compaction, the principle is here, it is reinforcing the soil, like it is, because it's you have a columnar inclusion and it helps in improving the bearing capacity. It is not by density alone, it is just the mechanism is very important, and drainage is another one. So it is applicable to mixed deposits of clay, silt and sand, soft and ultra soft silts, garbage fills, there are many things one can do. And the effects are that increased shear strength, increased stiffness, reduced liquefaction potential. Of course, these are also, like, you know, people have been using these techniques quite extensively in many places, in for example, in many of the east coast projects, west coast projects, there are too many, and it has been used in taxiways and runways, chemical plants, storage tanks, pipelines, bridge abutments, road and railway embankments. You know, if you want to connect rural areas by say for example, you would like to connect the rural road areas to mainstream, you have to construct a highway embankment. The highway embankment may pass through very, very soft soil where you cannot even walk. So how do you do that? So if you cannot, if you cannot improve it, then there is no way that those villagers can come into the mainstream, sell their products and all that. So what we do is that we should improve this soil between connecting the village and the town. So for that, you need to use some of the ground improvement techniques which are in this form. And people have different terminologies here, like people say that vibro composite, they call it, in some places they call it vibro flotation. And what is the size of the columns? Actually, you know, it could be 0.4 to 1 meter, you know, and then it is compact in point for this, you know, it can be even 2 to 3 meters as well, you know, it is just, you know, it all depends on your spacing and design. Actually, it could be about 2 meters or one meter or, you know, whatever point for, you have to design, you know, say properly. Say in a particular area, like, you know, the other day, there was one case where somebody was mentioning that the soil is so soft in that 40% of the soil clay was replaced by stones, stone column, which is quite a big number. So it's very difficult to really, you know, give a proper number here. One should do a design and then see its performance. So sometimes people do the casing as a driving, and sometimes they do boring, like and then put the sands. Sometimes injections are given. There are some mortar columns are also there. So there are many, like, you know, typically normal diameters will be 0.6 to 1 meter because that's what we normally use, and people can use crushed rock. Of course, crushed rock is also, you may say that it is all stone material, but then the possibility is that one can use any of the material that can be stronger than the clay. See, the thing is that you will see that if you have a stronger material, that takes load than the weaker material. So they have a square pattern or a rectangular pattern or a triangular pattern or whatever. Normally they have a square pattern, a triangular pattern, and the spacing is about 1.5 to 3.5 diameters. They provide strength reinforcement. I mean, they are quite useful in settlement stability. They act like vertical drains, and then normally you provide a blanket of 0.3 meters and the it acts as a drainage layer and also structural stress distributing layer. Like, you know, you can't put directly on the it's very difficult to put on a column. So you have some sort of stress distribution layer, which is, you will see that, you know, you have stone columns here, a couple of stone columns. You have a sand cushion which can take care of that load. So the column should extend to a firmer soil behavior to the extent possible. Because of the relatively high modulus of the soil, as I just mentioned, the stones have high modulus, like, you know, stress strain curve. If you just plot for the sand, for the stone, for the clay, definitely stone will have a very good stiffness. Like, the if you plot the stress strain curve, the tangent is nothing but the modulus. So what happens because of this is that large portion of the vertical load applied to the ground surface is transferred to the columns. So that's the reason, like, you know, you have a loading platform which is of a sandy layer or whatever, then you have stone columns. The moment you apply the load distribution takes place to the sand layer, and after that it gets transferred to the columns. And they are somewhat similar, but then, you know, you don't need to have, say, the pile caps, structural connections, like, you know, in the case of pile design, you need to go for much more rigorous calculations, and of course they are very, very costly, there is no doubt about it. Here it is much simpler. Like, you know, people have been using many materials which are stiffer compared to the native soil. That is the principle here. So here I would like to show some slides or some videos which can be quite useful in trying to capture what I want to say. There are two videos, one in vibro compaction and the other one is in vibro replacement, and this is this is given by, you know, the Keller company, which is a ground improvement company. You can see that they have the steps of various steps that are involved in the ground improvement operations. In fact, there are Dr. Venu Raju and Dr. Sri Harikrishna who were able to give this material for demonstration and for presentation this NPTEL program. You can see that they are doing this particular process here, whatever I just showed. Penetration with water jetting. You can see jets. They have extension tubes. You can see that. Coupling, it can air water supply. So they have an eccentric weight, they have a nose cone. Then you have, you are trying to backfill in the same place the sand. You can see that it's compacting. So some of these companies, they have automatic real-time systems in which you can see how much of sand has gone in or stone has gone in, and they have immediately the cone penetration test, immediately they are doing, you can see that. Real-time monitoring of ground resistance actually. So they are trying to see what is the resistance it has, like you can see that this is the old one, and the new one a little improved. At the bottom portion you can see that it was improved. So like this one can complete this particular in a series of lifts right from top 1 meter to, like you can come from top, and then there are many applications of this particular technique right from other things. And the other one was about stone columns. It's a rigorous job. Extension tube. You can see that. It's a tubing actually, air supply inside. Air supply. Stone feeder pipe. Because of the eccentric weight that it has, it introduced the vibrations actually. Aggregate stone is being fed into the stone bucket, like this has come from top and then you are trying to lower it. Then penetration using vibrations and pull down thrust. Vibrator starts compacting and forming the stone columns at the bottom particularly, and they are all looked at in real time. They will be able to see what is the fill, what is the depth of stone columns and all. You can see here, like they are looking at the bottoms. So once you complete, say at the top level, you can see that the compaction, you know, completion of the vibros, then you compact it again, see that. So they are measuring what is the diameter, because you need it for quality control. It has come very well. And of course, applications are too many here, like highways, bridge approaches, high speed railway embankment, storage tanks and airport and stuff, too many. So you have seen that, I mean, how vibro compaction and vibro replacement, that is the construction of stone columns, is done. Both have been very effective in many of the ground improvement projects. And what are the factors that influence the stone column behavior? People have studied, in fact, there are a lot of material available. The number one is undrained shear strength of the soil. Like, say, for example, if the soil is very poor, you have to definitely, it needs some sort of improvement, you know, because that's one thing. So what is the strength of the soil? Is it 10 kPa, 5 kPa? There are some soils which they call it ultra soft. They're just like water. So is it okay in that particular environment? So undrained shear strength of the soil is one thing. Then in situ lateral stress of the soil. So for example, if the soil is little stiffer, then the how much of confinement it can give. Say for example, the moment you put the stones inside, there is a tendency for the stone to go in this form. So to what extent there is a lateral resistance, because the lateral resistance should be good. If the lateral resistance is higher, the performance of the stone column is better. So that is one point. Then stress strain characteristics of the soil. Say for example, whether it is a soft soil characteristics, how is that? Is it a over consolidated soil or normally consolidated soil? How it can influence, that is one important variable. Then initial column dimensions, of course, this comes by design. Then friction angle and stress strain characteristics of the column material itself. Like say for example, soil, the soft soil is very poor, it has a, you can construct a stress strain curve which is a small, you know, it has a, you know, you start from a 0% level and then goes to maybe 20% strain level or 10% strain level. Then you also need to have stress strain characteristics of the friction angle, which will give you the C and phi and all other parameters for both materials. Essentially here the soil, we call it in terms of the cohesion, because we say that the there is only a cohesion, say for example 10 kPa, 20 kPa, whereas stone column material we say that it has got friction angle, say for example 30 degrees. And so all these factors will influence the response of the stone column behavior. What does it mean? Response means I would like to have improved bearing capacity, I would like to have less settlements. So if you want to have good bearing capacity, I must be able to have all these factors into my consideration. I must be able to use some of them in design. So that is what I mean. So like the, what is the typical value for the stone column? What is the load it can take? So normally engineers have a tendency to, what is the single pile capacity? What is the single stone column capacity? So one should have a rough idea. We will see how it can be calculated as well now. And actually a conservative approach is treating stone columns like piles. You know, that is one thing, whereas in a rational approach, loads are distributed between the soil and stone columns as a ratio. Like you have a stone column here, you have a stone column here, and what happens is that the you apply a load, actually this we call it a unit cell, and the thing is that the moment you have a load, the load is taken care of by this stone material, you know, as I just mentioned. The stones start taking load, and this load that is coming on the clay is less. Previously there was some load was, you know, actually there was nothing, there was some whatever is the stress, clay was taking, but now whatever load you are trying to apply, it is now being shared by stone column and the clay present. But then this being a better material, this this will take more, and then we call it what is called stress concentration factor, which is actually the ratio of vertical stress in the stone column and the vertical stress in the soft soil. Like we have a term for this, which is a ratio of stress in the stone column and the ratio of the stress in the clay, and it varies from 2 to 6 and usually 3 to 4 are the numbers. So in fact, you know, from fundamentals one can construct a simple equation like area of the soil, area of the stone columns plus area of the soil, that is a clay, into the total stress applied equal to, it can divide like this. Then the area replacement ratio you can define like this, how much of area in that you are replacing by stones, like area ratio is what the way sometimes that it is defined like this. So here you can see that, like as I said, total area divided by area of stones, like it can be, you know, it is another way, you know, people have say, in fact, if the this is one expression that people have as so the load that can be distributed by in this manner for the column as well as the clay are given in this form, where one can say that the n is that factor I just explained in the previous slide. This is the load taken care by the clay, this is the load taken care by the stone column. And there is also a term called a settlement ratio. We assume that it is one, we use a term called beta, which will tell you the settlement reduction ratio, because we would like to see that the settlement is minimum, you know. So for example, if I say that you are constructing a tank, you know, I say that the settlement has to be only 25 mm or 40 mm or 50 mm, something like that. So whereas in the conventional case settlement will be about a meter, I do not want that. So that settlement ratio one can express in this form, which is again a function of the area ratio and also the stress concentration factor. And we assume that the clay and columns settle equal amount. So the moment you apply the load, the both settle, like, you know, you have a clay here, you have a sand, stone column here, the moment you, because you have a loading platform at the top, you apply a load, they settle equally, but in the process the stone takes more load compared to clay. For example, I just want to give a small calculations example here. Ultimate bearing capacity of the stone column is given by a simple expression. It should be pi cu here, pi by 2 cu, and then sigma r. So cu is under shear strength of the clay, sigma r the effective radial stress as measured by the pressure meter. In fact, I just mentioned that like, you know, many of the tests we use, you know, like pressure meter, you know, like that is one of the tech, the methods to see the condition of the improved ground. We have both CPT test, SPT test, you have pressure meter also. The advantage of the pressure meter is that there is a radial expansion of the this diaphragm, and that you will get radial stress from that, directly you can measure. So that is roughly equal to, sometimes if the bearing capacity or the shear strength is Cu, it is twice. So phi is effective frictional angle of the material. So for example, I am trying to work out a simple example. If the under shear strength of the soil is 20 kPa, in fact this 20 kPa, so for example you are going to Mangalore area, it can be 10 kPa, 20 kPa like that, and then you have the stone material which has a friction angle of 40. So one can use an expression like this and then get the ultimate load that the stone column can take, because this is a formula here. So you will get about 51.1 kPa. You can see that the from 20 kPa it got increased to 50, you know, 55 with the presence of using the stone. So ultimate load on one diameter stone column, you can you can just calculate in this manner. So you can see that one can the load, you will get a 433 you know, some load, which is reasonable number. So one can calculate the capacity of the stone column, provided you know, the properties of the soft soil, properties of the stone material. So based on that, one can get this. And then normally some empirical relations are there. Sometimes if Cu is under shear strength of the stone column, by this process you can at least increase that by 25 times with a suitable factor of safety like 2.5 or something like that. So of course this needs to be treated with caution, because people have to do a lot of rigorous exercises here. And as I just mentioned, there are two patterns. One is a square pattern or even a triangular pattern. So for equivalent diameter, for a we call it equivalent diameter, for a triangular pattern it is 1.05 times S. S is the spacing of the stone columns. For square it is D, equivalent diameter is 1.13 S. This is what I was just mentioning. And see, this is the stone column which is completely stone, and then you know this is the load by the column, like you can see it is a higher number, whereas this is the load in the clay and this is an average number. Okay. You can see that this is sigma c, a lower value, whereas sigma s is a higher value, and then you get an average number. So this is what I just meant by the load sharing mechanism of the materials. Like, because somewhat the soil is somewhat soft, it cannot take load, this will take, that is it, that is the meaning. And see, once you try to construct this stone columns, we have to see under what conditions they fail. Like, you introduce a technique, you should be careful about the fact that that should not fail. So you are trying to now introduce stone columns, you should see under what conditions it can fail. So one classical example is that you have a long stone column introduced and the with a firm or a floating whatever, it can be ending at the you know, this can be a firm strata or it can be there is no material here itself. So the possibility is there could be a bulge like this. Okay. And normally this is restricted to 2.223 times D. Okay. This is one type of failure that one can have, you know, in the stone columns. And of course, it is not a failure, it is just that, you know, what is happening, the lateral resistance of the soil here is less. That is what I meant, you know, just now in the previous slides I said that the lateral resistance of the soil should be good. In fact, people have done lot of research to eliminate this, and they call what is called, they call it, you know, they are putting some geocell material or a geosynthetic material to avoid this type of bulging failure. We call it bulging of the stone column. If it does not bulge, it is good for you, is it not? You are trying to apply the load, load is transferred completely by this, taken care of by this. But if it bulges, there is a possibility that it is not very effective. So you would like to avoid it. So some people have done, you know, you just, you know, in your construction process, put a sort of a casing made of a geocell or some sort of material, and see that the, it is completely there, and you know, you, this sort of failure is avoided. Then suppose the material is what is called depth is less, there is a possibility that it could fail like this, which is a simple classical soil mechanics type of failure, which is called a shear failure. So that also we do not want. The third one is, you know, there could be a side friction and the end bearing, this type of possibility is also there. So essentially we should see that the these failure mechanisms are understood in a proper perspective, and the columns will not have these problems. So there is another expression that I have for ultimate bearing capacity, the group of piles, you know, say when I have a group of piles or the granular piles, we call it, actually we call it a granular pile, not an RCC pile. The Q ultimate is given in terms of the lateral stress into tan square beta plus 2C. C is average value tan phi B, and actually I just mentioned that the lateral stress sigma 3 will give you that influence. So that is coming here in terms of the gamma C B into tan beta by 2 plus 2 C, and then beta, the where this is a beta is nothing but 45 plus 5 average by 2 and C average, you know, these are all some simple expressions. Actually what we are trying to calculate is that we are trying to calculate, you know, soil is has some cohesion, sand has some friction. So since two materials are present, you are trying to calculate average values of cohesion for improved ground, which is quite useful. Like it is, we call it C average, and then frictional average, and then this is the saturated weight of the soil clay. For example, if you take it as 20 kilometer per meter cube, and you have, I am just trying to illustrate with another example, because what you saw just now was the capacity of a single column. Now how the group also behaves, one should understand. And say this is what I meant, like you have a single column, we know little bit, but you know this is like you assume that there is a load, you know, this particular, you know, you have a B is the width of the foundation, and say this is the, say for example, some tank or square building, and you are trying to calculate the all the parameters like lateral stresses and all that, and this is a whatever I just we are trying to calculate the same thing here using these parameters. And this approach is good for cohesion, values of cohesion more than 30 kPa, and use some of these properties like C equal to 30 kPa, phi s equal to 40 degrees, the AS is 0.5, and Poisson's, so some, you know, this is actually friction, and some of these factors if you just calculate, you can just see that the ultimate bearing capacity is about 254, you know. I use a 30 kPa material. Now I just increases it to 254. You can see that about 5 times I can increase the capacity of the load. Like, you know, this is actually, you know, 5.14 Cu is what is called the ultimate bearing capacity of clay. 5.14 into 30 is about 150. So I just, so if you know the Cu of the soil, 5.14 into Cu, we call it as ultimate bearing capacity. Now we have increased it to 254. It is about a good, about twice, close to 2, okay. These are all some more experimental results that we have on, you know, how the, depending on the friction angle of the soil, the stone column, what happens. So lot of research is done, like, you know, say for example, as I said, without what is that, this is a load divided by its shear strength, you know, I just gave an expression that the ultimate load divided is equal to 5.14 Cu, just mentioned that. So you can see here that without stone columns, you have that number 5 point somewhere here. This is a standard equation we have in basic bearing capacity equations. Now what I am trying to do is that I am trying to put some reinforcement stone column material here. And people have different researchers have given different types of equations, and they observed also in the field, like, you know, somebody from Bell, like Hughes, and there are so many. So you can see that depending on the friction angle and whatever is material available, there is some more literature is all taken. You can see that significantly that ratio, instead of 5.14, it can be as high as 15. And it is a function of the, you know, actually friction angle has to be at least 25 degrees of the sand. And if you increase the friction angle, you have an excellent effect. Like 45 degrees, you have some 15 to 35, you know, that ratio increases. So very, so the thing is, you have a good sandy material, or, you know, sand can be used as a, you know, we call it sand columns. Like, you know, if the clay is not, I mean, if the stone is expensive, use sand. And if you have a friction angle of 25 degrees, then definitely from 5 you are increasing it to 15 or whatever, 10 at least. So you can see that it is a very good improvement. Whereas if you have a very good material, definitely, like, you know, you can use, say for example, a construction debris, you can use, you know, particularly if you are trying to talk about sustainable development, no, aggregates, of course stones are quite expensive in you know, so some things could be done. So this is about another one where, you know, depending on the friction angle of the soil, how this distribution, load distribution is altered. This is another interesting thing from the field, you know, like, you know, because as I said, ground improvement techniques are done in the field, it is not in the lab. and people make lot of assumptions in doing the design, and it's very risky. They would like to verify to what extent they're correct. They try to check back their concepts and try to come out with lot of analysis, and this is one type of analysis. So, for example, this is the area of the A by AS, you know, area, total area divided by the area of the stone column, okay. So you can see this plot where if the, and then this is settlement ratio, okay. So the you can see that as the settlement ratio means settlement improvement. Actually, if the sandy material is very high, what happens? If you have a lot of sand, definitely the settlement reduction is very high. You do not want, you know, in a, particularly in sandy materials and all that, or in a stony material, settlements are going to be less. This is what is called infinite grid patterns or whatever. So, settlement ratio is going to be very less. But whereas you have lesser sand or lesser stone material, there is a marginal improvement, that is it. So, you can see that they have done for different materials, like, you know, say for example, greenwood for area of stone column as 1 meter square, like 1 meter or little close to that. And CU value means, which is called under shear strength value, 4 and 2. And so, he got some equation which is like here, you know, 1B, this is 1B1. So, 1A is here. So, then there is another way of, you know, people are looking at, you know, these are all measured, okay, like comparison of elastic theories and field observations. People have made some of these theories, you know, actually there are different theories based on, you know, the observations. Say, for example, whatever I have just said, phi and all that, they are all limit equilibrium methods. Like if I know the phi of the sand or the stone column, we use, you know, we are trying to say that you are putting the sand material inside, and then when you are applying the load, there is a bulging type of thing, and there is a resistance offered by the surrounding soil. So, based on this concept, which is called limit equilibrium concept, we have derived that equation, actually, that whatever equation that we had to calculate the bearing capacity improvement for a single stone column and multiple columns. This is based on some limit equilibrium methods, and we also have elastic theory approaches, like particularly by Praib and others, that I will show you. Yeah, here the Praib is there. So, you can see in this particular figure that for the field observations, essentially we are not interested in simple analysis, we would like to see how the theory works in the field. So, you can see here that the theory that the Greenwood had, which is essentially a cavity expansion theory based approach, he has CU equal to force N per centimeter square, and these are two values. You can see one curve here, the other one is here somewhere, so which means reasonably good. Then weighted modulus M, like, you know, actually the settlement is essentially a function of the stiffness of the materials. If the stone is very stiff compared to clay, it is 10 times here. So, you can see that 2A is here, 2A material, you can just see that it is very good. So, if ES by EC is 5 times, it is somewhat lower here, you can see that it is expected. So, like that, somebody has also done in terms of other things. Praib is another one, like I will explain that method in again in detail. Like for 37.5 degrees, it is somewhere here. This is again a theoretical method. Somebody has again done some more calculations, all those things are here. What I want to say is that it is a very interesting that you have theories and these are also measured values. So, which means that you have to have some theory to calculate, you also should have measurements to do the analysis, to confirm the analysis, and also to make sure that you have to give a guarantee to the actual persons who are the owners. Say, for example, you are trying to improve the soft soil properties in Kerala, I have to give a guarantee to the Kerala government or the Port Trust authorities that yes, the stone column is working and it has taken so much of load, you know, you had so much load from your containment facilities, and now this is a load that the stone column is taking, and the performance is going to be very good because it is tallying with all the field observations. So that is how I would like to justify my design. So this is another interesting point where you can see that the depending on the stone column spacing, spacing ratio of the treated to untreated soils, like, you know, so you can see that depending on the stone column spacing, what is the effect of settlement, settlement of treated and untreated ground ratio. Again, here you see that if the this ratio has to be, the settlement rate should be low, you know, because settlement in the case of treated material you expect low value. Say for example, instead of you may expect 25 mm only instead of 100 mm, so it came, it is 25%. So that 25% is here, and if the you can see here that the reduction is good in the case of you know, there are two materials here, there are, it is actually a function of the undrained shear strength of the soil. Okay, so in the case of somewhat stiffer soils, it has been there is a good reduction. Stiffer in the sense it is not very stiff, again, you know, it is good for stone column applications, that is what I meant. See, the it has been quite effective here, and here, say for example, in the case of if the spacing is 2 meters and the settlement of the treated ground to untreated, that ratio is actually more in the case of 20 kilometer per meter square, you know, in the sense it is about 55 to 60%, whereas it is up 10% here. Actually, this material is already stiff, you know, 20, 40 kilometer per meter square here, the material is already stiff, and definitely there is a good improvement, but the, you know, there is a small, so here in this case it is about 55, you know, I mean not 25 to about 45%. So you can see that is for the spacing. So you can really come out with some understanding of some of these things. Actually, these are all done in a lot of field studies, and actually this is another classical application in highways. Say for example, this is a highway embankment, you would like to construct the highway on that. Say for example, you are from some post soft soil areas, whether it is Paradeep or whether it is Kandla or whether it is Mangalore or Calcutta, where you have a lot of soft soils. You construct a highway embankment, maybe about 5 meters, and the classical thing is that the slip circle analysis should be done, and if the slip circle analysis shows that the factor of safety is less than 1, so you cannot really have any use of that. So what you do is that you construct the stone columns like this in this form, and then you calculate the you know, you can calculate the C and the phi. Earlier yeah, it is only C, you know, C of the soil and all that. So the thing is that you have you take the improved properties of the material, like, you know, from this you can calculate equivalent cohesion and equivalent friction of the stone of the material in which stone columns are present, and then use it in stability analysis, and you can get a factor of safety of 1.3 or 1.4. Earlier the factor of safety was less than 1, it is not acceptable. Now with the use of the stone column you can improve the stability of the slopes or the highway embankments in a comfortable manner. That is very important application in many of the stone columns. And actually this is some of the you know, normally in India we try to follow the IS codes. I would like to highlight the failure mechanisms that we just discussed earlier. They are again reaffirmed in IS code, that we have this bulging formation at 2D to 3D, 4D, and the short column is also like failure is also another possibility. Like, you know, what happens is that this is one type of failure that one can expect. So that one should avoid. You know, the fact is that you are trying to have that loading platform, you know, in this, see the soil is so soft here, and then but you have that loading platform, then this type of, which is again a sandy soil, and then you have a stone column here, this problem will not be there, as simple as that. Then this sort of, you know, the having side friction, you know, actually sometimes it depends on the type of construction or the method that we use actually. So if you are using boring methods and all that, the possibility is that you know, there is not much effective, there are gaps or some sort of thing. So the side friction may be very less, so it will not be effective. Actually the objective is that it tries to expand laterally, and then there is a lateral force in the opposite direction. When you have vertical force and then there is a lateral resistance, then it works. But suppose there is a slip in between, like, you know, like there are some gaps and all that and all that, so it will not be very effective. So we don't want this possibility also, like, you know. So essentially we need to understand the failure mechanisms and have enough so that they are not occurring in the in the construction actually. In the case of non-homogeneous layer, which means that you have some more soft soil somewhere present. So what it means is that you have a soft soil here and then reasonably better material, the failure plane is only here, it is not deeper. Again you have a soft soil here, the failure plane is only here. So this is what, so one should know that where it can fail, you know. So that, see, the thing is, why you are trying to do all these things is in a soil investigation, you should do a proper soil investigation and try to identify where are the weaker areas, where are the stronger areas, because soil is not uniform. So everywhere along total area, you must be able to find out exactly, you may say, for example, in this area, if this happens, the load carrying capacity will come down, okay. So possibly, you know, some of these things, you know, one should be careful. Say for example, this is also another problem. So one should see that the local bulging in some cases like this, you know, are possibilities, and one should understand that it is, one should avoid this, okay. So this is another type where we can expect, say depending on the loading. Say for example, you have a distributed load, you have working on a column itself. This is one type of failure. It starts from here, so a little bit, like there is a little bit of settlement, and then it just starts like this here, like this. So there are a number of issues that one needs to understand, and what you should do is that one should do load tests. There is one alternative that is the only way, and maybe I will discuss that in the next class.